Yeah, hello, very good evening, everybody. Thank you very much, Martin, for this invitation and this kind introduction. I'm very happy to be here, since also my friendship ties already with the previous institution, Workers and Punk Universities, have already endured for several years, and we were constantly thinking how and if I could contribute, and I'm very happy that now we found a way to make this possible. It's an honor and a great pleasure to me, especially due to the dense sequence of really brilliant presentations that I have been following these 2 days. So, I will start with a few terminological and methodological remarks to lay my cards open to you, and also in order to avoid a few misunderstandings, because my contribution will differ at some significant points from some, especially of this morning. In the first place, what do I understand by religion? Here I follow the definition, or at least the criterion, given by Emil Durkheim. Durkheim, as you will all know, says that the only feature that all religions have in common is not that they deal about something transcendental, it is not that they deal about gods or whatever. All these criteria would just apply to a few of them and not to all of the religions. What all of the religions have in common instead is that they all make a division between the sacred and the profane. So religion is not on the side of the sacred, religion is what makes the distinction between the sacred and the profane. This is very important, as you will see in the following. Of course, already here, it becomes clear that the task of materialism is much more difficult. It is much more difficult to state what side can materialism take with regards to this kind of religion. Whereas, if religion is just considered as dealing of transcendental forces or of gods, then it would be more clear where materialism would stand. I would claim that this Durkheimian description of religion as what draws a distinction between the sacred and the profane is what all religions have in common. But the question remains, is it only religions that draw a distinction between the sacred and the profane? Or do we have religions that draw a distinction between the sacred and the profane? And do we maybe also have other practices that also draw a distinction line, a division line between the sacred and the profane? This is the point where later I will refer to the works of Georges Bataille and Michel Leris. What I definitely do not buy into is the idea of Giorgio Agamben that every drawing a division line has to it something religious. That I definitely do not buy, so I would just refer to a recent example. If Austria draws a dividing line by erecting a fence towards Slovenia, this does not have anything to do with the sacred or the profane. So we have to acknowledge that some division lines go just between the profane and the profane. And on the other hand, there might also be dividing lines that go between the sacred and the sacred. So dividing is not always a religious act. Finally, another methodological step is I would claim that religious pertains to the sphere of ideology. Here I distance myself from the approach of Walter Benjamin in his paper Capitalism as a Religion. I find this paper witty, but I think it is misleading because considering capitalism, a mode of production, as a religion can form a kind of epistemological obstacle for investigating what specific relations capitalism as a mode of production can maintain with certain forms of religion. So it does not allow for investigating how this mode of production can have productive or unproductive relationships with certain types of ideology provided by certain religions. Still, and here again I would follow Durkheim's approach, I would claim that it is of crucial importance to think of all kinds of religion here and not only of specific types of religion, for example, the religions that have gods. There are other religions that don't have gods. Just think of the religion described and analyzed by Sigmund Freud in his essay Totem and Taboo. And I think in order to get a full picture, we always have to keep in mind this variety of religious formation, of religious ideology, because this whole variety produces a variety of ideological effects. What is the crucial effect of ideology? As you all know, since Ljubljana is a stronghold of theoretical Althusserians, to which I count myself as well, ideology produces subjects. So if there are varieties of ideologies, we can expect that varieties of ideologies will produce varieties of subjects or of varieties of subject effects, or they produce different types of subjectivization. So I will come back to that a little later. So now I come to my first part after the definitions. That could be entitled the post-secular experience. If we look around today and observe strange phenomena, unexpected phenomena like religious fundamentalism or also blossoming cultural fanatism, for example, phenomena that are now, I think, correctly referred to as health religious fanatism. One could also speak of animal religious fanatism, veganism, and so on. Or also fanatic kinds of nationalism. All these ideological forms show a strange kind of passion and affect that we thought had already melted away with the kind of capitalism of modernity that somehow allowed people to get a little more skeptical and more sovereign with regard to all these fanaticizing ideologies. So I think it was very right and witty that Martin Herrgut, in his introduction and invitation letter to this conference, referred to Marx and Engels, their famous formula from the Communist Manifesto: everything that is solid melts into thin air, everything that is holy gets profaned. Obviously, it seems that what we can observe, the phenomena that I have just enumerated, fanatism, religious, secular, nationalism, and so on, appear to contradict this formula of Marx and Engels. Apparently not everything gets melted away. Some things seem to resist, or even worse, some things even seem to be recast in this melting process. So some things which were not there before all of a sudden appear solid or even holy. So this strange recurrence, which seems to be specific for a situation of, I would say, postmodern capitalism, which is in a way the capitalism that we also call neoliberalism, postmodernism being the ideology of neoliberalism, I would say that this invites us to ask ourselves, what is here melted away by what, and what are the melting forces? And is it possible that the modernist melting forces have started to get melted away themselves by something else? But what is that? What melts away the progressive side of capitalism in a way? So I come to my second part. Everything that is solid gets melted into thin air. Everything that is holy gets profaned. One question would be, are these two sentences referring to the same process? Or is it possible that something solid gets melted away, but something holy is not getting profaned? Here I want to introduce a crucial theoretical tool or weapon, if you want. It would be the concept that I have introduced under the name of illusions without owners. Illusions without owners, this concept is something that I have developed mostly by taking the support of two witnesses. On one hand, Octave Malouny, especially with his influential essay from 1964, Je sais bien, mais quand même, I know quite well, but still. And on the other hand, Dutch scholars Johan Huizinga's wonderful study on the playing man, Homo Ludens, from 1938. What are illusions without owners? You can observe them in everyday experience. For example, you sit in a cafe waiting for a friend, reading a newspaper. The friend arrives, greets you hastily, says, hello, sorry, it's quite stupid, I know, but can I quickly have your newspaper? I have to know how this soccer game yesterday, Liverpool-Sevilla, for example, has ended. Or other friend says, hello, sorry, I know it's quite stupid, but can I have your newspaper quickly? I must quickly read my horoscope. So what is stunning here is, in the first place, that something which is admittedly stupid and the other admits that he knows is still considered as absolutely urgent. So there's a kind of strange contradiction between the urgence and the stupidity of this issue. And on the second place, there is also this strange preambula, this strange formula, I know quite well that this is stupid, which puts the subject at the distance of the illusion that still has a lot of power over this subject. So we find here a very strange relationship between a subject and an illusion. The subject declares it himself or herself at the distance of the illusion. So it's not his illusion. He does not believe this is important. He knows quite well this is stupid. This is a completely different structure that we find compared to the usual relationship between subjects and their illusions. Normally, we find owners. Normally, it's quite easy to find the owners of the illusion because the people declare themselves owners. They say, I believe in God, I really do. Or, I believe in human progress, I really do. Or, as the fighters from the Spanish War said, one day there will be peasants, owners of the land in the valley of Jarama. That's belief with an owner. Or, other example, there were people, nowadays you find them a bit more rarely, who said, I really believe in the self-regulation of the financial markets. Now they say it not so loudly, but they still sit on their professorial chairs and have not been removed after the biggest falsification that maybe ever occurred to any science in the history of sciences. But sticking to my distinction between illusions with owners and illusions without owners, I would say that here we find an interesting divide. Also with regard to the effects of these illusions. When illusions are owned, they produce a different effect than when illusions are not owned. Illusions that are owned produce self-respect. People are proud to refer to something great, be it God, human freedom, emancipation, self-regulation of the financial markets or something. Illusions without owners don't produce self-respect. People are rather a bit ashamed. Sorry, I know it's stupid, I have to, so formulas of shame. But they produce a lot of pleasure. It's still great. what is interesting here, when Octave Manoni describes this structure, it's of course gained from psychoanalytic experience. And normally, this structure is that of disavowal, verleugnung, as Sigmund Freud says, verleugnung being the mechanism of defense crucial for perversion. You know, repression, crucial for neurosis, disavowal, crucial for perversion, Verwerfung, foreclosure, sorry. Foreclosure, crucial for psychosis. So, repression, disavowal, foreclosure, neurosis, perversion. psychosis. But Manoni immediately says that here we encounter, so to say, everyday life figures of disavowal. Disavowal is not a specific practice only to perverts who practice with fetishes and so on. Also Freud had, if you remember, in his essay on fetishism, already remarked that the fetish somehow pertains to an illusion without an owner. The fetish arises precisely at the moment when a certain illusion is abandoned. As long as the illusion is owned, no fetish is necessary or even possible. So at the very moment that an illusion is abandoned, the fetish arises. But this, as Manoni perspicuously points out, is not only limited to perverts and fetishists. It is the basic structure of most everyday experiences, reading horoscopes, acting as if soccer results would be important, going to theater, going to cinema, and so on. There, every time we have this structure, I know quite well, this is just fiction, but still I burst out in tears, for example. Now, what shall we do with this? Manoni gives a very interesting hint in his essay. He says, illusion without owners are the basic type of illusion pertaining to every culture, and it's the oldest type of illusion. Illusions with owners, on the contrary, are a modern result, a late result in history. So, as with other things, we can say that private property of illusion is a historical result. It is not self-evidence or an obviousness. In the beginning, there are illusions without owners. Manoni has a terminology for this distinction. He calls illusions without owners beliefs, and illusions with owners faith. You also see French and English, there is this slight difference that beliefs can exist in the plural. You can have a lot of beliefs which are not yours, soccer, theater, movies, fashion, horoscope, whatever, but maybe you have only one faith. The word faith cannot so easily be put into plural. Now, what Manoni points out is beliefs can exist alone, faith can never exist alone. So we have either cultures with beliefs alone, illusions without owners, or we have cultures with beliefs and faith. Faith being a kind of superstructure of belief. This is a very good account, I think, which in a way gives a more clear theoretical structure to a debate that happened some more or less exactly 100 years ago in anthropology. As you may know, the debate and the battle between the so-called mythologists and the ritualists, where the finally, the ritualists won by claiming that it is not that people first believe in something and then start acting as something, but on the contrary, rituals are first and later on comes a mythology. And it's not only that the sequence in time is reversed, but that the mythology also always brings about a kind of misrecognition of what the rituals really are. So for example, you have a lot of practices of eating, but only very late, all of a sudden, these eating practices are interpreted as sacrifices to gods or something. So at the very moment when mythology superimposes itself upon ritual, or at the moment when faith superimposes itself upon belief, you have a certain type of misrecognition. This misrecognition has also been clearly analyzed by Sigmund Freud in his essay Religious Exercises and Obsessional Practices, Zwangshandlungen und Religionsübungen from 1907. So, if self-believing is a late result, we have gained a thesis which contradicts a whole narrative of modernity. You find this narrative in modernity as well as on the left as on the right. You have it with Georg Lukács as well as with Hans-Georg Gadamer. And I simplify this narrative a little bit. In Gadamer's, in Lukács' theory of the novel, this narrative goes like this. In the Middle Ages, the people were so happy with their naive beliefs, but now modern man has discovered science and enlightenment, and now all of a sudden we do not feel contained in this world anymore, and the God doesn't take care anymore of us. We are like adults without parents, or we are transcendentally homeless all of a sudden. That's Lukács' formula, no? But if what Monini says is true, then we have to paint a completely different picture. It is not true that in former times these naive people believed and were so happy in their stupid beliefs, and only later people got their doubts and became homelessness in their minds. No, it's the opposite. It's the opposite. In former times, people believed less. And it's a modern result that people started believing more. And the fact that in former times beliefs seem to embody themselves in more materiality, for example, big cathedrals, should not mislead us to conclude that also faith was there. No. As we can conclude from Freud's essay on fetishism, where we have more materiality, we have less belief. Or we have only belief, but no faith. We have only illusions without owners, but not with owners. As you may remember, Jacques Lacan once remarks that we erroneously think of medieval people as being totally faithful to God. On the contrary, Lacan says, in the Middle Ages, the priests constantly had to tell the people in the church, please don't throw the dice. So they entertained themselves completely differently. So what shall we think now of the formula, everything that is solid melts into thin air? Is that true if we can say in former times people believed less? Maybe it's not true. The beliefs were not so solid. It were illusions without owners, less solid than faith-owned illusions. What we can say still is there was materiality. That was, in the sense, solid, and that became critical and somehow melted into the air. It's not that the church has completely disappeared, but of course, as all artists among you will know, the golden times of artists with regard to church are over. It's difficult to build a cathedral or even to just paint a holy painting or whatever. So the good times of materiality, of abandoned illusions, is over, not only in religion, but also in other practices. We can see this increase of ownership with regard to illusions also when we roughly account to ourselves, for example, for the ways how people have been recruited in different times for going to war. So, for example, if you take 30 Years' War, which apparently was about religion, but people were just recruited by the next army and they tried to join the next best army because within the army they were safer than outside the army. In 1914, of course, this is different. All of a sudden, a new signifier, a new battle cry unites people and motivates them to go for war. It's the battle cry of the nation. This is faith, all of a sudden. 1939, the nation is not sufficient anymore as a battle cry. All of a sudden, what mobilizes people is ideology, either democracy against fascism, or communism against fascism, or fascism against all others, and so on. So there has to be even a stronger signifier or a stronger faith and subjectifying force. And if you think of today, what drags people into war or into readiness for war, there has to be an even more powerful signifier. If we bomb today, it is at least in the name of human rights, and nothing less. No? So we have really to have a very, very strong signifier. And nobody would go to war for nation, not even for communism or whatever, but human rights have to be there. So we could say recruitment functions with reinforced justification. That would be a kind of evidence for this idea that illusions without owners are older and that in former times people believed less than Now, so I come to my third part. What happens when a culture encounters a culture composed of belief and faith? Here my witness is Austrian philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein with his remarks from the 1930s, remarks on James George Frazer's work, The Golden Bough. As you may know, Wittgenstein is very critical with the findings of the anthropologist Frazer. I make it very short and simple. Frazer says, the savages believe in magic. That's maybe not so right, but at least they assume that the same causes will always have the same effects. In this sense, magic resembles more to more to science than religion does. And since they don't know better, they do magic. So they have faith in magic, so to say, and that's why they do magic. We civilized, on the contrary, Frazer states, we have got science, so we don't have faith in magic, and that's the reason why we don't do magic. Wittgenstein contradicts Frazer on both points. He says, in the first place, also the savages, Frazer's savages, Wittgenstein says Frazer is much more savage than his savages. Frazer's savages, it is very clear that they do not have faith in their magic practices. The same savage, Wittgenstein states, who, for example, does voodoo when trying to kill a remote enemy, or at least dealing with the effect of wishing death to a remote enemy, the same magic practicing savage, when the real enemy approaches, does not do voodoo with a little doll and a needle, but he takes an arrow and a bow and shoots this enemy. So the savage has a very clear line of distinction between a magical and an armed technical practice. And what about us? Second point of Frazer, of course, civilized people also have magic practices, Wittgenstein states. To give an example, not given by Wittgenstein, an instance of these magical practices committed by civilized people occurs to people in computer repair shops. As you all may know, one of the most significant causes of harm to computers is the fact that people punish their computers. So for a little dysfunction, they start beating the computer up and, as if the computer would get any better or improve after punishment. And we have many practices like this. We also talk to our cars when they don't start and so on. So Wittgenstein says the savages also do magical practices. It's just interesting that they are not aware of it. So if there is any difference between the savage and the civilized, it is the fact that the savage is aware and conscious of his magical practices, where the civilized is blind to his own magic. Now, what happens when a faith culture encounters a belief culture? We can see what happened to Frazer. We can say here occurs a significant illusion of perspective. When Frazer looks at the savage, he mistakes the belief of the other for the other's faith. So he says, ah, this guy does voodoo, so he must have faith in voodoo, otherwise he wouldn't do it, because I don't do it, because I don't have faith. So double misrecognition, and he takes the other's belief for the other's faith. To him, this other seems to be stupid and it appears not to know. He, Frazer, knows better and believes therefore he does not do. This is very often the case, not only when dealing with presumed savages, but you can see that even with very small narcissistic differences within one culture. I observed this once when commuting between Linz and Vienna. I was observing with astonishment that in Linz, on this Carnival's Tuesday, the city indulges in a lot of funny carnival rituals. When you enter a taxi, the taxi driver is disguised as Mr. Spock from Star Trek, and when you go to the bakery, the baker lady is dressed up as an oriental odalisque or something. And even very bourgeois elites indulge in playing the personnel of some soap opera from the television and so on. I never encountered that in Vienna, and I asked myself, why is that so? Of course, Linz is a kind of second city, whereas Vienna regards itself still as the center of the world. And I think that's the reason why Vienna people don't indulge in this. Vienna people think we are the center of the world. We are not stupid to do these silly mask things. We know that this is silly, and therefore we don't do it. And again, they take the other's belief as their faith. They think Linz people, obviously, they don't know that this is silly, and therefore they do it. That's exactly the Fraser position. But of course, again, this is a misrecognition. If the Linz people wouldn't know that this is silly, they wouldn't find it so funny. No? So, of course, they know quite well, but still they find it funny. They have illusions without owners and produce pleasure, whereas the Vienna people, from their knowledge, draw a different consequence, they go for abstinence. So knowing that this is silly can either draw you into practicing it and having fun, or you can draw the consequence of not practicing it and being proud and abstinent. So if we take this encounter as a kind of basic model of our understanding of enlightenment, when one epoch regards itself as more enlightened than the other, we gain some knowledge that was not available to the others. We are the civilized, the others are the barbarians or the dark Middle Age people who didn't know any better, and so on. These are the typical misrecognitions that occur when a faith culture encounters a belief culture. And what appears as a kind of progress in knowledge actually has to be regarded as a progress of asceticism, of abstinence, as a progress of internalization. No rituals anymore, no pleasure, no materiality, no masks, no fun, but just silent internality, knowing that this is silly and shutting up. So I think under these premises that Octave Manoni has nicely pointed out, we can say that what regards itself as enlightenment is rather a kind of process of internalization and a process of increasing hostility against the pleasure that culture can bring about. One may feel reminded here of the motto that Ludwig Wittgenstein gave to his philosophical investigations, the book that he wrote in the 1930s. He used a quotation from the Austrian comedy playwright Johann Nestroy, maybe one of the greatest comedy playwrights of all times, and an armed revolutionary of 1948's Vienna bourgeois revolution. And this Nestroy quotation that Wittgenstein uses goes like this, I quote, "It is in the nature of every progress that it appears much greater than it actually is." So I think this we could easily apply to enlightenment, a kind of misunderstanding and perspective illusion. So I think what we observe currently can be very well understood under these premises. Especially in the last decades, we observe an increasing hostility against practices that are practices of belief and not of faith, hostility against practices that function according to this formula of Manoni, I know quite well, but still. For example, this very strange phenomenon of all of a sudden uprising and blossoming hostility against smoking. Smoking is clearly a practice of belief and not of faith. Nobody believes that smoking is good and healthy. Already our grandparents warned our parents that they should not smoke and so on. Of course, nobody obeyed. And everybody who smokes could apply this formula. I know quite well that it is silly and not healthy, but still it is great to grant myself a moment that reminds me of big cinema, a moment that reminds me maybe of a scene between Lauren Bacall and Humphrey Bogart. So, no? So in this minimal pleasure practice, which is not very healthy, of course, there is also a kind of illusion without owner, and this makes this practice so particularly pleasant. The same goes for a hostility against the whole set of other rituals that are connected to belief of illusion without owner. This has nicely been described and analyzed by Richard Sennett when he describes that since the 1960s, maybe, in Western society there's a process going on that can be called the fall of public man. Now, where's the illusion here? Sennett says, Western societies since the Renaissance have developed a distinction between private, more or less authentic behavior for those people whom we closely know, and behavior in public where we behave totally differently, where we start acting. In order to go out into the public space, we have to become actors of ourselves. We walk a bit differently, we dress a bit differently, we speak differently, even in language in some kind. We have different formulas for speaking in public space and so on. So in public space, we act as if we were a bit better than we actually are. And this is not only more elegant and more polite, but this is also the dimension of public man or of the political citizen. If we are just private people, we are just idiots, according to the Greek terminology, just concerned with what belongs to ourselves, idiocy. But if we are public men, then we are also political citizens, and this is all based on illusions without owners. So if a certain apparently liberating ideology since the 1960s says be yourself and don't indulge in these silly games, again we find this hostility of faith against belief practices. I am myself, I know quite well that politeness and elegance is silly, that fashion is just an invention of capitalism and so on, so I don't do it. Again, ascetic consequence, hostile against pleasure, but also hostile against the political citizenship. Now, and this is, I think, very important to clarify, at this precise point we encounter the precise meaning of what Max Weber described as the disenchantment of the world. The disenchantment of the world, this formula of Max Weber, is often mistaken as a formula of enlightenment. But this is totally in opposition to Max Weber's own words. Max Weber says explicitly that the disenchantment of the world is not an effect of the sciences or of materialist philosophy, but on the contrary, disenchantment of the world is enacted by a fanatic religion. It is the hostility of religion, of faith, against belief, against magic or everyday magic practices. So when we in fashion and we are happy that we look glamorous for somebody else, we know we are not, but somebody else could have believed we are great because we are so fashionable. This belongs to the realm of belief. Disenchantment of the world erases this and says, since we know this is silly, we don't do it, we have to be ourselves and nothing else. And this is, Max Weber emphasizes, a religious stance. This is faith religion in its hostility against belief religion. Now here we could say what used to be holy gets profaned. What used to be holy in the sense of belief religion practice now is erased, is annihilated, liquidated in the name of a faith religion. It is also possible here to take another source as a witness here. I would remind you of the distinction by the German theologist Sundermeyer that also the German Egyptologist Jan Assmann has emphasized in recent years. It is the distinction between primary and secondary religions. Primary religions, Sundermeyer and Assmann claim, are religions who are afraid not to venerate enough of the sacred. For example, if there are religions with gods, they are afraid of not venerating enough of the gods. So they built, like the ancient Romans, temples for the unknown gods, so that there are no gods, we just didn't think of them. But anyway, they don't feel not invited and not addressed. So that's the fear of a primary religion. Secondary religion, on the contrary, monotheist religions have the opposite fear. They always are afraid to venerate too much, too many gods, too many things, too many saints, and so on. So again, we have here this interesting phenomenon, which is a bit counterintuitive, that late religions are not in a way proliferating the sacred, but on the contrary, they are limiting the sacred. Less sacred things, less holidays, less saints, and so on, and of course less gods. So the later religions somehow limit the space of the sacred, whereas the primary religions had a kind of blossoming, wide variety of religious sacred phenomena. Now I come to my fourth point. What is the melting force here? I think starting from psychoanalysis, one can give another analysis to this encounter between a belief and a faith religion. When, for example, Fraser looks at the savages, or when the people of Vienna look at the funny, carnivalesque Linz people, when this illusion of perspective arises, how does this other appear that seems to indulge in stupid practices? This other appears as if he were fully enjoying. This other is totally happy in his naive stupidity. These people in the Middle Ages appear to Lukács totally happy, unfortunately stupid, but it's their own luck. They are so happy and feel well contained in the world, and the gods take care of them. And only we somehow have undergone the castration of sciences and so on, and therefore we are so homelessness. So what appears on the side of the other is what Lacanian psychoanalysis calls enjoyment. The other appears as non-castrated. We have undergone castration by knowledge, symbolic order. We had to see how things really are due to science, and therefore we are deprived of this enjoyment. We are on the side of sad truth. The other is on the side of naive, stupid enjoyment. And I think, without exaggerating too much, one could say that the epoch of neoliberal capital and of its ideology, postmodernity, can be described as an ideological formation that is characterized by this constant concern about the enjoyment of the other. So, whenever the other says an ugly word, the other seems to be totally enjoying his nasty swearing. Whenever the other smokes, the other seems to be totally enjoying his nasty practices. He doesn't apparently know that this is not healthy, and maybe precisely because he doesn't know, it is not healthy for him. He only harms us. We are castrated, but he is not. And that's the reason why we have to castrate the other. We have to put it on every package of cigarettes that this is dangerous, because the other doesn't know. No, we have to somehow penetrate him with this castrating knowledge so that the other knows. And since the other constantly enjoys and we don't, it happens what always happens, according to psychoanalysis. It's not only that the other enjoys and we don't, but if the other seems to enjoy, then he is the cause of our non-enjoyment. The other has stolen our enjoyment. He is the thief of enjoyment, as Žižek calls it, or the other is the cause of our castration. Because the other is so naive and totally enjoying, we cannot enjoy, we are so sad in our situation of non-stupidity, and that we have to fight, so we have to erase the other's enjoyment, so at least that the other also does not enjoy, so we have to kill, in a way, the cause of our castration. And this obsession with the enjoyment of the other leads to a situation where we are extremely sensitive for anybody who feels that the other enjoys. So whoever feels that some other might enjoy and feels offended by this enjoyment of the other is now respected. Postmodernity and neoliberalism have a lot of understanding for the sensitivity of for the vulnerability of citizens. Of course, this is also the only right that neoliberalism grants to the citizens. You have a universal right to feel harassed by whatever it may be. If the other plays piano in his apartment, you can call the police. Of course, that's harassment the other enjoys. Or if the other is perfumed and sits maybe here in the lecture hall, please call the police, feel free. The perfume police will immediately come and remove this enjoying other. So I think what I've tried to caricature a bit for the sake of clarity shows how this obsession with the enjoyment of the other introduces a process where neoliberalism can act out its interests of privatization, of destruction of the public space, because public space, of course, as Sennett describes it, means that we act as if the other could not harass us. If the other has some embarrassing feature, we act as if we hadn't seen it. If he says something nasty, we act as if we hadn't heard that, and so on. That's our contribution to public space. That's how we act as public men or as political citizens. But postmodernity tries to destroy this force, tries to somehow subjectify us with the obsession of the enjoyment of the other, and encourages us to call for the police so that the public sphere can be destroyed and that we can implement an increase of repressive forces in society. I think this is another feature of something solid that has not melted into thin air. On the contrary, here we find something solid that has newly emerged. You encounter this, for example, on airports when you want to enter an airplane, all this solidity of apparatuses and police people grabbing you are a proof of an increase of repression in society. Or think of the situation of the universities, especially in England, where students all of a sudden start claiming that Immanuel Kant's writing should be banned from university because Kant at some point uses the word race. They didn't read as far as to find out that he also uses the word nigger, but already the word race is sufficient for them to claim that Kant should be banned and prohibited from university. What I want to emphasize here is this particular paradox that it is today a specific kind of people who calls for the police. I would claim it is the anti-authoritarians. It is the after 68 people who preferably call for the police today. Either the old anti-authoritarians from the 70s and 80s, like the Greens in Austria, one number one candidate for police measures and implementations in society in Austria today, or their children, anti-authoritarian way raised children, who call for police on university campuses. So this is an interesting paradox, that anti-authority today calls for authority, and that we can only understand if we claim that anti-authoritarianism was an ideological way of obsessing people with the enjoyment of the other. They could not imagine an authority that is not castrated. They only could imagine a kind of primordial father, and everything that appears foreign to them threatens them to be a primordial enjoying father. Also paradox, the change in the party strategy. Austrian Greens emerged in the 70s and 80s as the party that wanted to legalize soft drugs, and they wanted to have the right to sit in the Emperor's Garden in Vienna on the grass. Second thing was achieved finally, but today they fight on the one hand for the legalization of soft drugs, but on the other hand they fight for the prohibition of cigarette automats in the streets, and for the obligation to have a number plate on a bicycle. So this is green politics today in Austria. So I come to my fifth point. I think what we encounter here is a sequence of ideological formations. And this also means that we have not only different ideological formations, but also different types of subjectivization. I want to describe this in topological terms, just as Sigmund Freud did it with regard to his topological patterns of the psychic apparatus. And this is, I think, an important augment or an important amendment to Louis Althusser's theory of ideology. Here comes into play what I mentioned in the beginning, that it is, to my mind, important to look at all kinds of religion, also at the religions without gods, for example, the Tibetan religions, and also to look at the pagan religions, who had a variety of gods, in order to understand how ideological interpolation and subjectivization works. Althusser, whose essay unfortunately remained a fragment, has only elaborated on one type of subjectivization, which for him was Christian religious subjectivization, where the small subject relates to a big subject. But this is not the only way how ideological divisation functions. If we put it again according to Manoni's pattern in a kind of chronological scheme, we could say, first, there is belief. What happens in belief? If there are in belief any gods, which is not necessary because also taboo religions function according to the principle of belief, of illusions without owners, but if there are gods, it is interesting and stunning that in pagan religions, the gods can be children. You have these little arrows, this naked little boy who shoots around his arrows of love. Or you have sex-craving gods and goddesses. They want to have sex with human beings and rape them and whatever. So these gods are not morally better than the human beings, maybe even worse. You also have alcoholized gods, like Dionysos, for example, drunk gods. So the gods do a lot of nasty things and they are not particularly responsible. They are in any way intellectually, morally, in terms of alcoholic level, always under the human beings, not higher. So belief functions as an interpolation where the authority of the interpolation is situated below the interpolated subjects. When we are practicing belief practices, we always obey to the observation of a more naive instance than we consider ourselves to be. Just one instance of this, when you go out into the city and you say, okay, I have to dress a bit more carefully, otherwise what should the people think? No? Then you address an authority which is lower than you consider yourself. You know quite well what you really are, but if you look a bit nasty, then other people might think that you are quite nasty. So you have to obey to these other people's, to these stupid observers' rules. Or politeness, as a civilized practice of belief, as Senate states, also refers to this lower authority. If you want to be polite, you have to learn how politeness functions. You have to learn how to shake a hand, at what speed, with what strength you grab the hand, if it really comes from your heart, but you squeeze the bones of the other. This is not polite. So you have to do it in a proper way. You know how it was meant, but the other does not read your intentions. The other just reads how it looked like. And if it didn't look perfectly, politeness failed. So you have again to obey to the commands of a more naive other who only looks at the appearances. Politeness is pure appearance. This, of course, led scholars of Greek pagan culture always to the question, did the Greeks really believe in their gods? 19th century was full of this question. Friedrich Engels remarks this. Paul Venn has dedicated a study to this question. And of course we can say, well, it depends on what you call belief. If we follow Manoni's terminology, this is belief believe in the proper sense. I know quite well that it is silly, but I have to follow the commands of little naked arrows. In this sense, it was belief. But of course, it was not faith in the Christian sense, in believing in a higher, wise, asexual, old God. This is faith. In faith, interpolation comes from a big subject that people consider to be more intelligent, with higher moral standards, infinitely just, and whatever, no sex, and so on. That's faith interpolation. Small subject, big subject, well elaborated by Althusser. So in one case, topologically, we have the subject above its authority, looking down at this naive observer, but still obeying its command. On the other hand, we have the subject looking up to a big subject and obeying the big command. In both cases, and here I think Sigmund Freud was particularly clear in his study Mass Psychology and Ego Analysis from 1921, when he stated that the interpolated subject never considers himself or herself to be identical with this ideal. If this ideal now be higher or lower, but neither the belief subject nor the faith subject feels identical with his God. The God may have features that the subject doesn't have, and this ideal also provides standards to which the interpolated subject may not always be able to live up. So I try to be polite, or I try to be a good communist, a good Christian, whatever, but I always have a certain distance between my reality and the ideal that I should live up to. I never arrive at being a good communist fully, and I'm never at the goal. The same goes for politeness and so on. So this distance is very important with regard to faith and belief, because it distinguishes itself from this postmodern formation that occurs when we are totally obsessed with the enjoyment of the other. Then we do not have an instance that is lower, we don't have an instance that is higher, we have an ideal that somehow surrounds us. It's the superego that is somehow surrounding the ego, like in concentric circles, and the superego constantly injuncts the ego with the injunction, be yourself, be yourself. Don't move anywhere, don't live up to a higher standard, don't live up down to a lower standard, just be yourself. In Lacanian terms, this is the injunction, enjoy. I think here arrives what we could call a new solidity. People are totally resilient against faith or belief injunctions, and they don't want to live up or to live down to anything. They just want to be themselves. They just want to be their idiotic, pathological, empirical identity and nothing else. This allows for a pattern of ideological structure in the society, which I have called negative hegemony. As you may recall from Gramsci, traditional positive hegemony consisted in the elites pretending that their goals were universal goals of society, and thus the bourgeois elites, for example, was able to gather the proletarians behind themselves when they went into First World War. So they made the other classes believe that it was also in their national interest that Austria, Hungary, Germany, Italy, and so on went for battle in order to gain colonies, and that we all will live better if we win this war. This was positive hegemony. So the particular interests of the leading class was presented as the universal interest of the whole society, and the other classes somehow bought into it, especially the Social Democrats. But I think the postmodern ideology functions according to the reversed model. Since individuals are interpolated as be yourself, it is now possible that the elites present the universal patterns as particular patterns only pertaining to the elites. So rationality is not something that is open to every human being. No, it's a lie, it's a conspiracy of old white men. It's not for black women, children, and no. Don't live up to such an ideal. remain in your stupidity, abstain yourself from this conspiracy. This, I think, could be called negative hegemony, or we could also say it is a kind of renouncing the booty of a class struggle. It's renouncing of what class struggle is about. So since all the others just want to be themselves, they don't make any claims for something that would allow them not to be themselves, education, whatever. So again, you find that in many cultural struggles, all of a sudden the whatever black gay ice hockey players only want to see movies made by black gay ice hockey players and so on, and nothing else, because only that will confirm our identity. We can only understand this. We cannot see movies of female, whatever, yellow ice hockey players. So that would alienate ourselves from ourselves. And I just want to give one counter image to this abstinence. Well known to you. I take it from the book by the Swiss psychoanalyst Paul Parin, who died a few years ago and who was a volunteer to the Tito partisan armies. Together with a few Swiss doctors, he joined the Tito partisans, and he very nicely describes that the partisans almost never had arms to themselves. So in the first assaults, they always had to attack German forces in order to take away their arms. So the only delivery of arms to the partisans came from the enemy. And I think this is what we have to keep in mind with regard to cultural struggle. We always have to take over arms from the enemy, and we have to be ready to do that. Otherwise, we are not cultural partisans. So I come to my last point. I think when paranoia rules, it rules with absolute urgencies. Be yourself means be immediately yourself, not later, live up to it so that in 3 years you might be a good sportswoman or a good communist. No, immediately. And that means also that you have to sacrifice immediately everything. So paranoic ideology is constantly structured with urgencies. It's like the pop-ups on your computers. Something pops up and has urgently to be fulfilled. For example, security as an issue pops up, and then everything has immediately has to be sacrificed for security. So please, everybody, remove your shoes or whatever. So that has to be fulfilled immediately. Or when health pops up as an issue, you have to immediately sacrifice everything for health, of course. And so the paranoid subject is not, as the faith subject or the belief subject, able to get at any distance from these injunctions. The paranoid subject is always ready to sacrifice everything immediately. And the funny dialectic here, of course, is that when we are ready to sacrifice anything for one issue, like for example for security, then we sacrifice really everything, including security, of course, because when you have more surveillance, more cops around, then the feeling of insecurity arises. People start to buy arms, firearms, start shooting each other when little misunderstandings occur and so on. So the insecurity, of course, increases. Or when everything has to be sacrificed for health, we sacrifice everything, good life, elegance, manners, politeness, whatever, but also health, because this new healthism, this fanatic religion of health, has already brought about victims. There's a new illness now that has already got a term by medical research. It is called orthorexia. It's an illness which is caused by the fact that people only eat healthy things. So that's a kind of bad nutrition and has very severe consequences. So, to come to my last point, I would claim that what we call good life is what is described by the belief practices, which are the practices of illusions without owners, and that this is what, from another perspective, can also be called the sacred of everyday life. Now, if it is right that belief practices produce pleasure, we have in the next step to ask ourselves, is this pleasure difficult to have? And unfortunately, we have to answer yes. There is, as Aaron Schuster coined it, trouble with pleasure. I have in detail analyzed this in my 2011 book, What Life is Worth Living For, Wofür es sich zu leben lohnt in German. So, there is trouble with pleasure. So, what we have to abstain ourselves from here is this narrative that says, well, human beings are pleasure-seeking animals and only in some rare cases culture achieves to somehow seduce them up to higher goals or convince them that they have also to follow higher goals. Normally they are just seduced by pleasures, and if we would not constantly try, they would just watch television or play on the PlayStation or so. But I would claim that this is still a naive, illusionary narrative, and in fact, things are much worse. My witness here is Bertolt Brecht with his poem, Don't Let Yourselves Be Seduced. You know how this poem goes. Lasst euch nicht verführen zu frohn und ausgezehr. Don't let yourself be seduced to hard work and exploitation. This is where seduction aims at. People are not seducible to pleasure. People are seducible to renounce pleasure, and that's the difficult thing, and that's what we have to fight for. The difficult thing is pleasure, that people insist on pleasure, on good life. They are easily seducible to something else. And why is that so? Well, again, we have to say, since pleasure is connected to belief, and belief is this, I know quite well, it's silly, but still, we have always an ambivalent relationship to pleasure. And this ambivalent relationship is testified by the linguistic feature that the notion for the sacred, as Sigmund Freud remarks, in almost every Indo-Germanic language has this double meaning of, on one hand, being something sublime, but on the other hand, also being something filthy. So, good life, being the sacred in culture, is not only sublime, but also filthy. It is a kind of double-faced entity that you can immediately discover whatever pleasure you may think of. So there was a nice radio program in Austria where young people were asked, what do they think of the saliva? And they thought they find saliva disgusting, even their own saliva. But what they find not so disgusting is the saliva of the beloved person. And I think they were completely right, it is true. And it's not only that the saliva of the beloved person is not disgusting, but of course, on the contrary, then this, if the person is beloved, then this may even be a kind of precious gift and sublime and so on. So there's a, all of a sudden, there's a kind of positive quality to it. And that goes for every pleasure, and not only pervert things that turn into great things like pain or so, but you have that with every simple pleasure in culture, that it has this double face. If we find it great to have beer, the next morning we don't want to think of beer, for example. Every single source of pleasure has this malign, filthy dimension to it. If we like to party and find partying great, on the other hand, we abstain ourselves from it because it costs money and it costs sleep and recreation. Even very harmless pleasures like going for a walk. Yes, but we don't do it because it costs time, it's a waste of time, and so on. So every pleasure requires a certain transgression from us, a transgression beyond our normal boundaries of economy, of economizing recreation, time, money, and so on, sleep. So this is the reason why pleasure is problematic. Maybe this can be even traced back to the facts of castration, that we always tend to see in pleasure full enjoyment, and since we are all symbolically castrated, full enjoyment is always uncanny and not pleasant to us. Enjoyment is suffering. So pleasure is uncanny to us, and only under certain conditions it can become benign, can be become enjoyable. What are these conditions? I think this is a crucial function of culture. Individually, people abstain themselves from pleasure. There are too many malign qualities to it. But collectively, people can overcome their boundaries. So they need an injunction by culture, for example, a few friends coming by in the evening, ringing at my doorbell and saying, Robert, come on, you have worked enough today, come on with us, we have to celebrate the birthday of a comrade and we have to drink beer now. And then I thought, okay, maybe they're right, and I leave my work and go. Alone, I wouldn't have had beer this evening. Or it doesn't have to be explicitly outspoken in this sense, don't be a spoilsport, come with us, do these nasty things with us. It can also be embodied in the architecture, in the design of objects. So when I come to a certain bar and there's a certain dimmed light and cool jazz playing, then I hear like the voice of culture that says to me, Robert, please don't order some juice now. So again, by my personal idiocy, I would have gone for the healthy drink, but culture allows me to, it encourages me to transgress my boundaries and become more elegant, more courageous, more sovereign, and act as if this wouldn't harm me. And I, of course, order a single malt or something. And so this is the most important function of culture, to encourage people to go beyond their idiocies, their private boundaries, their individual economies. And of course, it is clear that neoliberal culture, neoliberal ideology, postmodern ideology, by producing this paranoid injunction, be yourself, describes this liberating injunction of culture, don't be a spoilsport, as the ultimate patronizing force. No? Others want you to drink alcohol. No, please resist. Say, I am myself. I just insist on juice and I don't. No? So this is the spoilsport dimension of this paranoid culture. But there is more at stake. If it is right to say it, I would claim that the sacred of everyday life, that these moments when we transgress our boundaries is what life is worth living for, then we can also say the sacred always has to be celebrated in order to be pleasant and not to be disgusting. And this is the power of solidarity in culture. And here comes in what I announced to you, what I find considerably important, the works of Georges Bataille and Michel Leris, who introduced this notion of the sacred of everyday life. This is precisely this problem in culture, that people in very minimal rituals that are not connected to any recognized religion interrupt their profane life and, for example, go for a coffee with a colleague and decide not to talk about work. That's sacred of everyday life in a miniature, where you interrupt the sequence of profane practices and grant yourself a moment where you do not serve your self-reproduction. This is the sacred of everyday life. It contains this injunction and this solidarity, come on, don't be a spoilsport, go with me. And what is important here is that this is not only the source of pleasure and what life is worth living for, but this contains also a political position, a minimal ethic that allows people to be political citizens. Because, as Georges Bataille puts it, normally when we just work for our self-reproduction, we are, in a way, the slaves of our life. Then we serve life. But in some moments, when we celebrate, then we stop serving life. Then we are masters of our life. Then we are at eye level with our life. No? When I go to a Saturday evening party, I can say to life, listen, life, now I have worked for you the whole week. But now, life, what can you offer to me to give me back? No? Then I speak from master to master, and I'm not just enslaved by life. But Tai puts it nicely in the words. He says, you eat in order to live, but you don't live in order to eat. And this minimal difference is the difference between slavery and sovereignty. And I think, and that's my last claim, when people, due to this paranoid formation of ideology, due to this neoliberal ideology are encouraged to refuse the solidarity of culture, are encouraged to refuse the injunction not to be spoilsport, they are also encouraged to refuse their sovereignty, and then they refuse their claims for good life. And I think this is the ultimate reactionary ethics that we have to fight today. This is the religious struggle that we have to fight. Against paranoid religion, we have to defend the sacred of everyday life, which belongs to the sphere of belief, and which allows people to make a claim for good life. If people are educated not to make a claim for good life anymore, then these people are very easily to be ruled and to be treated as slaves. And here, my very last point, my witness is against Bertolt Brecht. I just want to remind you of this well-known poem by Bertolt Brecht, Resolution of the Communards, of course the Paris Communards, where Brecht lets these fighting communards say to their enemies, "Knowing that you will shoot at us with guns and cannons, we have now decided to fear bad life more than death. In Erwägung, dass ihr uns nun eben mit Gewehren und Kanonen droht, so haben wir beschlossen, von nun an schlechtes Leben mehr zu fürchten als den Tod." When people stop fearing bad life more than death, they are slaves. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you very much for this long and interesting lecture. Now it's time for the debate. And okay, we already have a question here.
Yeah, regarding this faith-belief distinction, do you have any comments on, let's say, some recent developments in like Western popular culture? For example, you had the 90s, this grunge or hip-hop authenticity, you know, coming either from the streets or unwashed shirts or whatever. But then after the 2000s, then comes the trend of hipsterism, which is basically reappropriating past cultural forms, but with this sort of ironic distance towards it. So it seems that this has more of a belief-like structure as opposite to the, let's say, faith-like structure of popular culture in the 90s. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yes, I think I can follow your argument. Maybe my ability of differentiation is not as subtle as yours in this case, but yes, I think this is not a univocal process, and of course, maybe public man can at some point be resuscitated.
Thank you. I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about how capitalism comes into play with this specific, you know, distinctions between, if I understood correctly, beliefs and faith, but then also this paranoia. So you mentioned this idea of paranoia limiting you from just enjoying or just having some pleasures, but at the same time we know that, well, at least from television, we know that capitalism wants you to buy things, you know, to spend things. So how does exactly this come into play? What is your specific take on this? And an additional question, or a comment maybe, that a lot of how do you a lot of what you were describing as modern or postmodern ideas seem to me to simply be American or English in general ideas. So I don't know. Could you be? I mean, does it mean that we have one capitalism and that it is all basically American capitalism, or is there any differentiation in this sense? Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Pilo. Again, I would claim that. Of course, this is a matter of hegemony, and I would say the capitalisms are different, but there's a cultural hegemony of US and British capitalism over the others, and so we start slowly to adopt the issues of US capitalism. Just to give one example that you know, that we had in our conversation. During the 90s, in Austria, in the art scene, post-colonial theory was enormously hip. And that was in itself a bit comical because Austria, as you know, did not really have colonies, at least not in Africa or Asia. And but everybody in the art scene was totally obsessed with post-colonial questions. And so Austria installed a professorship for colonial studies at Vienna's Art Academy, yeah? Not for political economy, anthropology, whatever, the post-colonial studies. And I think this, in effect, in itself is a paradox because it is an effect of colonialism. No? It's a hegemony of the United States where post-colonial issues may play an important role over the culture of Austria where post-colonial questions don't play such a role. I would say that, and the same goes for smoking prohibitions and so on, were executed first in the United States. The other part of your question, of course, you're right to state that capitalism cannot live without needs and without creating needs, as Marx already described in 1857 in his introduction, the Critique of Political Economy. Capitalism is the first mode of production that does not only produce goods but also needs, artificial needs, so to say. How does this work in a basically ascetic economy or basically ascetic ideology? But look, how does it work? No, what are the promises of so-called cultural capitalism? What commodity can you buy today which is not somehow charged with some faithful issue? You cannot just go, almost at least not in the United States, to a fashion shop and just say I want to have a fashionable jacket or a hip shoe. No, every shoe that you can buy either is the twin of another shoe that goes to some child in Africa, or the shoe is charged with some certificate that this will not harm the environment or something. No? So I think this is particularly interesting in terms of cultural history, how the promises of fashion that you will be hip and represent something for the illusion of the other is replaced by own illusions. You now can be faithful and proud. You did not just buy a shoe, but you bought a shoe for a child in Africa as well. And again, this ethical fashion is, of course, in a way paranoid because it constantly replaces its urgencies. No, and first there was ethical fashion, so we had shoes that were definitely not produced by children and footballs that were not sewn by slaves. But then ethical fashion immediately was replaced by ecological fashion, so we had shoes that would not harm the environment, maybe produced by slaves or children, we didn't care anymore. So this is how I think cultural capitalism under ascetic premises functions.
If there are no imminent questions, then perhaps I have one. When we were talking about how this contemporary culture is characterized by a constant concern for the other, for the enjoyment of the other. And you described this, you mentioned it in connection with the word neoliberal. So I was wondering why exactly say neoliberal instead of just contemporary, in the sense that, okay, you mentioned that it's connected with a certain privatization of anything, but so would you say that here neoliberal is used in the same sense that we tend to understand it as a certain political-economical project? So in what sense does the word neoliberal has to be used here instead of just contemporary, if I made myself so clear? Yeah. So how is it connected with Thatcher?
Okay. Well, maybe in one point, again, negative hegemony. Society does not exist. No? This is total opposition to liberal capitalism before. Society existed, and you have to be disciplined and work for society and to be a valuable member of society. No? At the moment when society doesn't exist, hegemony reverses itself. Just take care of yourself, be your own entrepreneur and whatever. No? And maybe I can throw a bit of light from one other perspective which I have omitted here. I think the real scandal of these postmodern cultural policies, like for example these smoking prohibitions, I think this is really, I'm not particularly interested in smoking issues, and I understand if somebody cannot bear smoke, but I think we should not overlook the political dimension to this. What does it mean when a government all of a sudden starts treating its citizens like children and prohibiting them to smoke? No? This is utmost infantilization. You are not able to deal with this yourself. You are not able to know what is good for you and what not. No? And that at the moment where issues that you really cannot decide are left over to you. No? You shall take care of your pension or so on. No? How can I know what is good with my pension? But I know how much I want to smoke and when I want to die or not. No? I think here we have also this shift in cultural politics. In modernity, citizens were constantly interpolated as adults. You have to be adult, you have to sacrifice your pleasure and work in a disciplined way, and then some progress will come about so that even the suppressed classes finally will also profit from this wealth that you produce with your discipline when you behave like an adult, but you can smoke because you're an adult. And then shift, okay, no, work is pleasure, you can realize your creativity, immaterial work, Lazzarato, a dream, no, you can work whenever you want and wherever you want and so on. No? Wonderful, no alienation. Yeah? Of course, surplus always still goes to Bill Gates or whoever, but wonderful. But you are completely contained in this pleasure, but you are like a child. No, you must not smoke because you're too childish. And that is still sold to us as a kind of reason. This is what I have called pure reason against the filthy sacred. No, we know what is healthy and we now take care of health and security and all these issues, environment, all pure reason. But this pure reason, again, is an agent of infantility. No? This is what five-year-olds adopt as pure reason. No? This is what your children, if you have some, tell you when they are 5 years old. Don't buy this aluminium paper for your food. This is bad for environment. No? They like to teach their parents environmental consciousness. No? But even the most smart 25-year-old students don't have a notion of class struggle. No? 5-year-olds have an ecological pure reason, but the more impure reason, thinking of the conflicts of society, is completely suppressed. And I think this pure reason has this significant mark of infantility because it lacks the distance that adult people can have towards themselves, but also towards their own reason. No? That's vernunft and reason in the true sense, that you can get at the distance of your own reason, or that you can limit your reason to the places where it belongs. No? When there is carnival, it is not reasonable not to be silly. No? Of course, normally we're not silly, but this reason should not be universalized. Some moments mean that if you're reasonable, you are unreasonable. And in order to provide a formula for this, adult reason is being reasonable in a reasonable way. So reason has to be applied to itself in order to be really reasonable. Otherwise, it's pure unreason. And postmodernity, in its infantilization, always reduces us to this one-dimensional pure reason without any distance of reason towards itself.
Okay, there's another question there.
Yes. Thank you very much that you started your talk with a reference to Durkheim and his notion that the division between the sacred and the profane belongs to the sacred. That's a very important point. But also that what is most important in religion is not beliefs, but actions, that is, rituals. That's a fundamental fundamental point that was completely forgotten later by structuralism, Lévi-Strauss, etc., etc. So to illustrate this, I'm thinking of a joke. Well, it's more, I think it's a, I think it's a true story, but it sounds like a joke. It's Niels Bohr. You know the story, of course. Okay. So when Heisenberg, his former student, paid a visit to him in Copenhagen, he noticed that above the door he had a, I don't know what, a horseshoe, what, any kind of gizmo, etc., to protect the house from the evil eye of the others. So Heisenberg said to his old master, "But do you really believe that this is a protection?" And Bohr rejoined, "No, I don't believe it. But so why do you keep it?" "Well, I've been told that it works, even if you don't believe in it." Yeah. So, okay, something more serious, but very much related. You cited a great number of French thinkers. You forgot one. I mean, I'm kidding, of course. Jean-Paul Sartre. And the chapter on bad faith in his treaty called Being and Nothingness. And in that chapter, you have the phrase that, of course, for analytic philosophers, rationalist philosophers, sounds like a foggy, froggy kind of thing. But to believe is not to believe because it is only to believe. In other terms, belief is always undermined by doubt. So belief is very weak. And nevertheless, we continue to explain things like, for instance, the Islamist terrorism today by reference to what these people are supposed to believe, and that we, rational people, are completely unable to believe, namely that there are 36 or 72 or whatever number of virgins that are expecting them to. So I think this is a very important point. Beliefs are very weak, and that cannot really explain action, especially extreme actions like this form of terrorism. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a remark.
Thank you very much for your remarks. Maybe I can add two more remarks that can build up upon this. First remark, I think, is important when we deal in a critical Marxist sense with religion. It is important to keep in mind that religion is not at all about believing something or having faith into something, but in the first place, it's about celebrating. And celebrating is precisely that practice that turns malign, filthy practices into sublime, benign practices. So I think it's very clear, for example, with even simple objects, when you just want to have champagne, it is just disgusting. You have to celebrate something in order to find champagne not disgusting. You know? Or, of course, in sexual therapy, it's well known that when people live together for a long time, somehow profane life takes over and they don't manage to feel sexual desire. But this is precisely because they are not able to celebrate these disgusting things. And so at the very moment when they are at a hotel or at some other fancy place, all of a sudden playfulness comes in and all of a sudden it becomes possible again to have sexual desire and not to be disgusted by this profanity. So I think this is the important thing that Bataille would have emphasized, that celebrating is this transformative force that brings people to appreciate things that are normally considered as disgusting. And one illustration to this, you may remember Sigmund Freud's quotation of Heinrich Heine in his treatise on the uncanny. You know, in somewhere in Austria at a lake, a ferryman has to deal with some very nasty customers which are a bit threatening, and after a while he finds out that these customers are the Greek gods in exile. You know, this is the novel Gods in Exile, and Heine has this very nice line, when the gods are not celebrated anymore, they become demons, they become filthy and ugly. So this is the interesting point of the sacred. Already Aristotle has this formula, the sacred has to be kept sacred or celebrated in order to be acceptable, otherwise the sacred becomes filthy and disgusting. And I think postmodernity is a kind of culture of disgust that encouraged disgust exactly by the removal of the forces of solidarity that would allow us to transform this disgusting side into something great. So when we celebrate, actually we celebrate our own capacity to transform the nasty sexual things or the champagne into something great. We somehow always celebrate ourselves in a way. Second remark, no, I stop here, sorry. Maybe one second remark, if you allow. Yeah, you can have it again, because you were referring also to fundamentalists. And here I have an interesting source, which I find quite revealing. Maybe you know this Christian writer Tertullian, man who lived around 200 of our times, very important figure when it came to transforming Christianity into the hegemonic language of Latin. So they only had a few scholars who were able to enter this educated Roman world. And Tertullian, a man who lived in Carthago, was one of these key heads, intellectuals of Christianity. The man was only a Christian for 11 years of his life, then he was excluded again for radicalism, but he still is regarded as one of the leading fathers of Christianity, and his texts are really revealing in many respects. So look at De Spectaculis on the spectacles, about theater, sports and so on. This is all nothing for Christians, Tertullian claims. Why? Well, just listen to what the sports observers say. They say the boxer is immortal. Or the theater people say the actress is a diva. Ha, says Tertullian, this is pagan language. No, they make mortal people gods. No? This is pagan religion, even if they don't know that they are pagans. Same as Max Weber says, this ascetic spirit is Protestant even if it doesn't recognize itself as religious. Ascetism is always Protestant even if they don't recognize themselves as religious. Same argument in Tertullian, they are pagans even without knowing it, but when you listen to them carefully, you see that theater is a pagan practice, sport is a pagan practice, and so on. Very interesting here, the militant ascetism, if you compare it to the Muslim terrorists of Paris, one could say they look as if they had taken their target list from Tertullian. If you look what early Christianity was extremely hostile against, it was exactly the same targets. Sports, stadiums, music performances, and drinking wine in public, being elegant and civilized and so on. That's all what Tertullian wanted to forbid for Christians. And also interesting with regard to this belief-faith distinction, Tertullian is a witness for the fact that the veil for the Muslim women was not an invention of Islam, because the veil existed 400 years before Mohammed, at least. In his writing about the cult of the women, where Tertullian deals about the question whether women should be allowed to use lipstick and things like that. And of course you can imagine how the argument goes, no? God creates human beings after his own image, and what do the women do? They use lipstick. No? Tertullian says, we Christians, we should take this Arabic young ladies as our model for our young women. These Arabic ladies are so wonderfully veiled, that should be our model, that's where we should go. So the burqa is Tertullian's model, and this is 400 years before Islam. And that shows a theoretical point, I think, that I have tried to emphasize, that the belief practices are always older than the faith practices. And when we look at the other culture, the other's beliefs appear to us as their faith. They believe in the burqa, these primitive barbarians, but to them, it is a much older practice of belief that preceded religion for centuries. And I think it would be revealing to imagine ourselves thrown into a more liberal culture that deals in a different way with the naked body. Imagine that we would have to go to a place where it would be customary that people run around only with pullovers, but downward naked, no, a kind of naked butt culture. We would find that utterly disgusting, and we would, of course, keep our trousers on. And then they would ask us, is that because you're Christian? And we would be completely surprised why they ask us that. No? We would not take this shame embodiment that we have as somehow connected with some religious education, but maybe the others would perceive us like that. And that's exactly what we do with these veiling practices today, which don't have anything to do with the prophet and the faith.